Good morning and welcome. My name is Dee Dee Kamhai and I will be your service leader today. You are welcome here. We welcome you whether you are filled with joy or deep in mourning. We welcome you whether you are well-known or unknown, articulate or silent, able or disabled, old or young. No matter who you are or how you live in this world, we welcome you to this sacred space. Come worship with us. Our announcements were on a slideshow before the service. If you didn't see them, don't worry. They will be posted tomorrow in Matt's sharing. So I just want to say I want to welcome you with live from Fellowship Hall. It's our LCUUF Sunday service. Welcome. Can I do it like this? As we light this chalice, let us set our attention to love and help each other, or at least to do no harm. Let us remember that we are called to be our best selves, both here with our beloved community and also in the face of the many challenges we encounter out in the world. Please light your chalice.
Good morning. Once upon a time, wasn't singing a part of everyday life as much as talking, physical exercise, and religion? Our distant ancestors, wherever they were in the world, sang while pounding grain and paddling canoes or walking long journeys. Can we begin to make our lives once more all about peace? Finding the right song and singing it over and over is a great way to start. And when one person taps out a beat while another leads into the melody, or when three people discover a new harmony they never knew existed, or a crowd joins in on a chorus as though to raise the ceiling a few feet higher, then they also know there is hope for the world. And that was from the renowned American folk singer and social activist, Pete Seeger.
Each week, we take time to remind ourselves that we belong to a community which cares for each other. We do this by sharing any significant joys or sorrows in our lives. If you have a joy or sorrow to share today, you can type it into the chat now and we'll read those aloud. First, let us voice our sorrows or concerns. Whatever you or the world may be holding that is in need of our healing and caring thoughts, you're welcome to type sorrows and concerns in the chat box.
We have a concern from Liz Mulder, who says, concern for the people of India, where the pandemic is raging through the population. My goddaughter is Nepalese and her father is East Indian. Stuti, my goddaughter, and her brother are living in Texas currently. They are the people I visited several years ago, two times in Africa. Please light a candle of love and hope for Karen Carpenter as she meets her Seattle oncologist tomorrow. That's from Trudy and Lou. We also have a concern from Kathy Coches, who says, please light a candle for Karen Carpenter as she has an appointment with her oncologist tomorrow in Washington.
Now let's recall the joys. whatever you may be celebrating, whatever evokes a feeling of joy or peace for yourself or others, you're welcome to type joys into the chat box now.
We have a joy from Kathy Coaches, who says that Kathy's brother-in-law, Ken, is doing well after surgery on Wednesday to replace two heart valves and is coming home from the hospital today. And I have a joy, this is Colleen, that a family of 15, my family, got together unmasked because everyone had vaccines for a Mother's Day celebration yesterday. Looks like that's all.
And this candle from our care team represents those sorrows that are too raw, too difficult for us to share aloud. So many of us have had losses, partners, children's, grandchildren, losses that remain present with us every day. So many of us have burdens, anger, fear, and frustration. All those things that weigh heavy on our hearts, we will light this candle for all those unspoken sorrows. Okay. Today's speaker really needs no introduction. Michael Reason has been a part of our services for well over 2 years, consistently providing us with great music during the services. His long career as a professional orchestral conductor and pianist has given us an insight as to how music has been a force to change in society. He originally gave this talk last July, but due to technical difficulties, he was unable to present it as originally intended. So we have invited him to revisit this talk today, and it's entitled A Melody for Change.
Once again, music throughout history has often reflected social and political changes. This has certainly become more prevalent since the beginning of the 20th century. What you just heard was an excerpt from the Czech composer Antonín Dvořák's Ninth Symphony, one of the most beloved works in the orchestral repertoire. Composed in 1893, it is tuneful, pleasant, and musically very comfortable, perhaps a reflection of the world that the composer found himself in. With the turn of the century, major advances in industrialization and society started to happen. The development of the automobile and the achievement of manned flight are but two inventions that contributed to a changing rhythm of society. Music followed rapidly, reflecting a new forward momentum. 20 years after Dvorak's comfortable and tuneful New World Symphony, the world heard this. You two have heard that piece after 128 years, but the world 20 years after the Dvorak piece you originally heard had heard that. And that was Stravinsky's music for the ballet, The Rite of Spring. In its first performance, it created a riot in the theater. This barbaric, dissonant, and violently rhythmic music was just too overwhelming for the cultured Parisian audience. The sounds and power of increased industrialization were being reflected in music, pushing traditional harmonic and melodic creativity to its limit. The cliff edge was finally reached after the horrors of the First World War. A new world order and the immense change to society that followed the end of the war contributed to the complete breakdown of tonal music. The Austrian composer Arnold Schoenberg finalized this breakdown of tonality by eschewing traditional composition and created a technique of composing that was basically mathematical in design. For each piece, he created a theme comprising of the 12 tones of the chromatic scale. The theme would only use each tone once in any order desired. What followed would be a musical development of this theme throughout the duration of the composition. The result was the complete dissolution of 300 years of traditional musical composition. Well, fortunately, this mathematically induced compositional style did not endear itself to too many followers and eventually would fall out of fashion. Both Stravinsky and Schoenberg created music that was a reflection of the society in which they lived. But in the coming decades, music would turn around from being reflective to a driving force for change, both politically and socially. Now, this, of course, probably requires a week's worth of talks to cover it all. So instead, I will take three examples to illustrate how music in the 20th and 21st centuries facilitated change. The 20th century saw the development of more genres of music than the previous four centuries put together. What helped this, of course, was the development of radio, records, and television. These technological advances quickly made the world a smaller place, and music could be distributed on a much larger scale. It's not surprising, therefore, that music now had the potential to affect change. The first example I would like to share goes back to 1939, and one song that in many ways started a movement that continues to this very day. Until the late 1930s, music hadn't directly confronted the issues of racism and segregation. Then along came Billie Holiday's recording of Strange Fruit. The founder of Atlantic Records, Ahmet Edegun, called it a declaration of war and the beginning of the civil rights movement. The song is a stark depiction of black bodies hanging from a tree after a lynching. Back then, popular song wasn't a place for brutal truths, and Holiday would have been well aware of the trouble Strange Fruit could create. She later described the audience reaction when she first performed the song. There wasn't even a patter of applause when I finished. Then a lone person began to clap nervously. Then suddenly, everyone was clapping.
Southern trees bear strange fruit. Blood on the leaves and blood at the root. Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees. Pastoral scene of the gallant South. The bulging eyes and the twisted mouth, scent of magnolia, sweet and fresh. Then the sudden smell of burning flesh.
The song went on to sell over 1 million copies. The clue to its power is the way the lyric simply describes the scene, making us, the listener, take it at face value. Without suggesting solutions or even to inform of the extent of the problem, Strange Fruit simply instills feelings of disgust and deep sadness. Many of those affected by the song went on to march together in support of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., and their grandchildren are now doing the same for the Black Lives Matter movement. There is no doubt that Strange Fruit had an immense impact on the way people thought about race, and in no small way helped to create a change in racial attitudes. Societal change and prejudicial attitudes would come front and center when Berry Gordy founded Motown Records in 1959. Berry's label really showed how much music could change people's perceptions and make political statements that would contribute to the anti-war and anti-poverty movements of the late 60s and early 70s. Under Gordy's leadership, Black artists were given opportunities that just a few years before would have been unthinkable. The creative, soulful pop of Motown artists like Smokey Robinson, The Temptations, and the Jackson 5 won hearts, not just in the United States, but around the world. Suddenly, closed minds were opened to the idea that African American musicians were just as worthy of attention as their white counterparts.
Look at
Oh, sorry. I just can't help but dance to that kind of music. As its artists matured, Motown released music that went beyond pop and into the realm of social and environmental awareness, political protest, and a re-energizing of Black pride.
Whoa, oh, mercy, mercy me. All things ain't what they used to be now. Where did all the blue skies go? Poison is the wind that blows from the north and south and east. Whoa, mercy, mercy me. All things ain't what they used to be now. Oil wasted on the oceans and upon our seas. Fish full of mercury. Oh, oh, mercy, mercy me. All things ain't what they used to be now. Radiation underground and in the sky. Animals and birds who live nearby by the night. Oh, mercy, mercy me. All things and what they used to be. What about this overcrowded land? How much more be used from man? Can't you stand?
Groundbreaking work of this generation of African-American artists would continue through to the 21st century with rap and hip-hop. Music has also made leaps and bounds for gender equality. The past 30 years has seen a long history of songs that have stood up for women's rights. But back in 1963, this song felt shocking to many as the image of the subservient woman gets turned on its head.
You don't own me. I'm not just one of your many toys. You don't own me. Don't say I can't go with other boys. And don't tell me what to do. Don't tell me what to say. And please, when I go out with you, don't put me on display. 'Cause you don't own me. Don't try to change me in any way. Don't own me. Don't tie me down, 'cause I'd never stay.
When I first heard the song, Leslie Gore later said, I was 17, and feminism wasn't quite a going proposition yet. My take on the song was, hey, I'm 17, and what a wonderful thing to be able to stand on a stage and sing to everyone that you don't own me. Gore's spirit has lived on through every woman who has ever decided that they wouldn't be told what to do by men. Promoted musically through the likes of Aretha Franklin's R.E.S.P.E.C.T. and to the inspiring pop of the Spice Girls and Destiny's Child. Now just imagine young girls all over the world in 1996 watching slack-jawed as the Spice Girls ran amok in some dusty mansion, somersaulting across deserts and making snooty old men blush, all the while singing about female friendship and empowerment.
Ha ha ha. music.
If you want my future, forget my past.
If you wanna get with me, better make it fast. Now don't go wasting my precious time. Get your act together, we could be just fine. I'll tell you what I want, what I really, really want.
So tell me what you want, what you really, really want.
I wanna really, really, really wanna zig a zig.
If you wanna be my lover, you gotta get with my friends. Make it last forever, friendship never.
Songs like Wannabe had the effect of making young women the world over more determined that they will not be ignored. It's a spirit that today is exemplified by the likes of Lady Gaga and Taylor Swift. Powerful women seizing total creative control and bending the music industry and society to their vision. Music can be considered just about the fastest acting agent of change on society imaginable. A song has the ability to turn the status quo on its head. This can be seen very clearly in the changing attitude towards human sexuality in the 1970s and 1980s. Of course, there had been artists before the 70s performing material that touched on same-sex attraction. You can even go back to 1828, when the pioneering blues singer Ma Rainey recorded Prove It On Me Blues with the following lyrics. Went out last night with a crowd of my friends. They must have been women, because I don't like no men. Wear my clothes just like a fan. Talk to girls just like any old man. Because they say I do it, ain't nobody caught me. Sure gotta prove it on me. It was, however, the two decades from 1970 where artists and their music managed to bring LGBTQ lifestyle into mainstream culture and consequently an acceptance of it by a wider society. That song, Stonewall Nation, dates back to 1971 and was written and performed by Madeline Davis. Davis is a lifelong gay rights activist and wrote the song after attending her first gay civil rights march. The song, widely regarded as the first gay liberation record, and its uncompromising lyrics, which demand freedom rather than just acceptance, celebrate the resilience and potential power of radical gay activism. On the other side of the Atlantic, a year later, in 1972, David Bowie would shock Britain with a live performance of Starman on the hugely popular Thursday evening show Top of the Pops. With the conservative British public still not used to the idea that homosexuality was now legal in England and had been since 1967, Bowie created an outrage at 2 minutes and 17 seconds into the song by draping his arms around the guitarist Mick Ronson.
To phone someone, so I picked on you. Boom, boom. Hey, that's far out, so you heard him too. Boom, boom. Switch on the TV, we may pick him up on channel 2. Look out your window, I can see his light. If we can sparkle, he may land tonight. Don't tell your papa, he'll get us locked up in fright.
Now today, we can't really imagine how Bowie's actions could offend anyone. But back then, the British Broadcasting Corporation was bombarded with complaints. The indignation of parents would only endear the otherworldly Bowie to their children. For the generation that would spawn the out-gay pop stars of the 1980s, Bowie's outrageous campery and sexual androgyny was a revelation. And for many watching on that Thursday evening, life would never be quite the same again. Bowie paved the way for so many artists whose music made a contribution to the LGBTQ movement. Artists like Prince and Madonna were the Bowies of the 80s. And today, we have musicians such as Sam Smith, Melissa Etheridge, Adam Lambert, and Brandi Carlile who are openly gay and very proud of it. Music really did make a huge change to society's acceptance and understanding that there is no normal to sexual orientation. Finally, if there was one musical event that changed the entire world, then it must have been the one held on Saturday, July the 13th, 1985, exactly 26 years ago. In October 1984, the BBC transmitted a report showing images of hundreds of thousands of people starving to death in Ethiopia. Michael Bjork, the reporter, described it as a biblical famine in the 20th century and the closest thing to hell on earth. The report shocked the UK. It also shocked Bob Geldof, head singer of the Boomtown Rats. And in an effort to help the starving population, persuaded many of his musical contemporaries to collectively record a single called Do They Know It's Christmas, under the all-embracing group name of Band Aid. The record became the fastest-selling single ever in Britain and raised $14 million for the relief effort. So emboldened by the success, Geldof and his fellow organizers, Midge Ure of U2 and Boy George of Culture Club, set their sights on a massive concert event that would be held simultaneously in the UK and the US. The result was Live Aid. Many of the most famous musicians across the globe donated their services to perform at the concerts. On that same day, concerts inspired by the initiative were held in other countries, including the Soviet Union, Australia, Canada, Japan, and West Germany. It was one of the largest scale satellite link-ups and television broadcasts of all time. An estimated audience of 1.9 billion people across 150 countries watched the live broadcast. That was, at that time, was nearly 40% of the world's population. At the event's core was music, and in raising $127 million on that day, the world collectively came together with a humanitarian consciousness for the disaster happening on the African continent. And that is why Bob Geldof was knighted by the Queen. After the event, Bob Geldof ultimately said, "We took an issue that was nowhere on the political agenda, and through the lingua franca of the planet, which is not English but rock and roll, we were able to address the intellectual absurdity and the moral repulsion of people dying of want in a world of surplus." So, during the past 30 minutes, we have, in a small way, explored how music has transformed from not only being a reflection of society's changes, but also as a vehicle capable of influencing political agendas, human attitudes, and sexual freedom. Now, I'm well aware that there are a multitude of artists and songs that could have been included in this presentation, and I'm sure you all have examples of music that helped to create a change in society. But finally, I would like to leave you with one final video that shows how, even after 50 years since its release, a song can still have power and meaning to a society that still needs to find its way through the challenges it faces. The classic song, "What's Going On" by Marvin Gaye, truly encapsulates, both in 1972 and now in 2021, why we will always need a melody for change.
Hey, what's happening?
Brother, what's up?
This is a good recording, man.
Yeah, brother, like, stop right on.
Mother, there's too many of you crying. Brother, 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 there's far too many of you dying. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Father, Father, don't need to escalate. You see, war is not the answer, for only love can conquer hate.
You know we've got to find a way
to bring some love and get here today. Picket lines and picket signs, punish me,
sister,
with brutality.
Sister,
talk to me,
sister,
so you can see,
sister,
oh, what's going on. Judge us simply cause our hair is long. Oh, you know that we've got to find a way. Bring some understanding here today. Oh, oh, oh. Picket lines and picket signs. Don't punish me,
brother,
There's brutality. Come on, talk to me. You can't see what's going on. Yeah, what's going on? Tell me what's going on. I'll tell you what's going on.
Right, right on. Right on.
This is the time in our service when we ask you to remember that we share our gifts here through pledging and donations. We're not meeting in person now, but our connections to each other and our contributions to the community continue. Instructions for payments to the fellowship are on a slide during the announcements before the service every week. And while you're considering your gifts to the fellowship, remember that each month LCUUF donates 5,000 pesos or more to an organization providing food aid in our lakeside community. For the month of May, we will be supporting Poco a Poco, a nonprofit providing food and other assistance to San Pedro Itzican and other villages near Chapala. When you pay your pledge, please add something for Share the Basket as you used to place pesos in our physical basket. You can donate in the same way that you pay our pledge, but please donate Share the Basket separately or indicate what part of your donate is for Share the Basket. Your offerings are gratefully received. Let us extinguish our chalices with these words, which we read together. We extinguish the flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we keep in our hearts and share with all the world. Michael?
Our closing words today are by the author and inspirational speaker, Alan Cohen. Your soul has its own song. Your unique energy and purpose are expressed through your talents, passions, and visions. When you're in touch with your joy and act upon it, your heart feels full and your life is rewarding. When you're disconnected from your passion, you feel empty. Your life is frustrating, and you wonder what you're doing here. Yet even when you're distracted by the fears and troubles of the world, your song still lives inside you. Its tune is etched upon your soul more deeply than any experience could be. As you move through difficulties, detours, or setbacks, your spirit guides you from within, urging you to carry on and emerge shining. In the face of a great challenge, your inner knowing comes forth in unprecedented power. All your life lessons help you get back in touch with the music of your soul. Others may try to influence you to sing their song rather than yours. If you do, you'll become resentful and lose your voice. To regain it, get back in touch with your truth and act on it. Never deny your expression for another's. You can harmonize with and support someone else, but don't do it at the expense of your own happiness. You best serve others by reminding them of their song. Judgment, punishment, and power plays don't correct. They only drive human beings further from their joy and aggravate pain and self-defeating behavior. When someone is in distress or conflict, help them remember who they really are, and they'll have no need to hurt others. Authentic self-expression brings healing, release, and relief. Remember your song, and you'll become magnetic and compelling. You'll also find peace within yourself. Our postlude is a virtual recording I produced last year featuring members of our local Lake Chapala Community Orchestra and an international chorus comprised of people from Mexico, the United States, Canada, and the United Kingdom. So here they all are, performing one of the happiest songs of the last 50 years, ELO's Mr. Blue Sky.